plus one early.
Hello. Hello, everybody. Merry Christmas. I forgot to do two things. I forgot to tilt my computer so that it's more facing this corner. And I forgot to turn off... One moment! I forgot to turn off my closet light. Hey, everybody, welcome to the Christmas show. I'm Christmas, and we've got a small selection of trailers and ephemera and things for you tonight. Let me just start playing some stuff in the background here. Let me get the volume back up, huh? How's that? Let's get a little volume on this stuff. You gotta... That's not enough. Okay. So, tonight's gonna be a little unusual. Everything that you're watching right now... Oh, I should back announce... Maybe I should back announce the music. Those were all songs by a band called Christmas. And, I'm very clever for, I didn't even look in a mirror to see how this hat looks. This is actually a nightcap that I literally own. Because at one point I had very long hair, and I thought maybe it would be a nice solution to the long hair question. So, the songs that we just heard, if you're tuning in live on Twitch, those were, we started with Big Plans from In Excelsior Day Glow, and then we listened to Three from their, posthumous album, Vortex. We heard Jupiter, Florida, Hand, and God Bless the Fireman. And then we ended with a rare song called O Holy Night. It's the only actual Christmas song that I believe they recorded. That is from a Boston Rock Christmas. That is an EP that's on YouTube, I think. The whole thing's on YouTube. Everything we're watching tonight, right now, everything that we're watching currently is from FT Depot. Let me tell you a little story about what happened with this show. I prepared a completely different stream tonight. You see, what happened was I just forgot that it was Christmas. And or that this week would be the Christmas show. So, I started preparing a Christmas show. Then I pivoted. I had this kind of smart alecky idea that I would do something kind of different. And it didn't really come together at all. Then I was asked to work. We traditionally do these streams on Thursdays because I don't work. Well, I was asked to work. And I requested, hey, could you please let me out early? Since I'm doing you this nice favor, I have something in the evening I would like to try and do. I wasn't hopeful. I actually kind of thought, like, well, I'm probably going to wind up canceling the stream. So... what I did is I just kind of grabbed a bunch of stuff off FT Depot's YouTube page. This is where all this stuff that we're looking at right now, that's where that came from, that's where that's from, that's where all that is. We do have one thing to watch that's proper. Oh, this one's cool. Check this out.
I hope so, boys. This is a special holiday message to moviegoers.
That's a handsome Santa.
All over the world.
Sorry, I'm just. I'm,
have we ever let
I'm,
you
I'm
down?
Sucked in by this one.
Roll it, Eddie.
Check this out. Isn't that cool? Oh, this should have been the pre-show loop. So, tonight, we're gonna watch one thing. And, then, first we're gonna get rid of that. Oh, we've only got a few more. Okay. So tonight on the program, we're going to watch a compilation that I did not bother to figure out who actually finding out information. Okay. YouTube user actors317 compiled what we're going to watch this evening.
To all our wonderful customers, may this Christmas be your merriest. May this New Year be your happiest.
Get rid of that.
Is the sincere wish of this.
And it's going to be lightly attended. I know it's near Christmas. I didn't really promote this, but I figured we'd give this a shot.
While shepherds watch their flocks by night, all seated on the ground.
The bright lights of Christmas.
Wait, let's watch this first.
The ageless face of benevolence.
Actually, no, let's
the
not.
The timeless face of innocence. The hopes and the prayers.
So tonight,
the season of goodwill.
We're going to watch a compilation.
Whoever you are.
Of.
Wherever you may be. The season's greetings.
Siskel and Ebert.
Be in good health and in good
reviewing Christmas movies
throughout the coming year.
It's a little under an hour.
Just in time for the holidays, it's the second annual Siskel and Ebert Holiday Video Gift Guide.
You don't need this game.
I figured we'd just chill out. Check this out. Look at those guys. Look at that painting. Isn't that great? Now, there's no need for this, remastering the intro in 16:9. I believe the majority of this is 4:3. We celebrate Siskel and Ebert on the holidays. We do each and every day. Ebert is so much happier to be famous.
Family Christmas tree.
What do we think?
Jimmy Chase tries to survive a family get together.
What do we think of Christmas Vacation?
Christmas Vacation. It's one of five new movies we'll review this week on Siskel and Ebert, and I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune. Our first film is National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation, and unlike the other two films in this series, this one isn't even remotely funny. It also lacks enterprise. It's the only film in the series where the Griswold family doesn't go anywhere.
Wow.
They stay stuck in their suburban Chicago home, some vacation. Chevy Chase and Beverly D'Angelo again play the Griswolds.
So Siskel's actually saying that European Vacation is better than Christmas Vacation.
I want to have Christmas here in our house.
Have fun with your cookies. Please check back in.
I wanted to have a big family Christmas.
The joke here is that all sorts of weird relatives...
Save some for me, huh?
...upsetting everything and everyone. After the in-laws show up, it's suddenly scuzzy cousin Randy Quaid and family.
We were gonna call, but...
I read something recently where they, somebody was like, I never thought these movies were funny because they're classics.
If I woke up tomorrow with my head sewn to the carpet, I wouldn't be more surprised than I am right now.
The humor is mostly slapstick.
I'm not gonna comment on that.
For example, when Chevy Chase is locked in his attic... by his mother-in-law.
Oh. Oh.
This movie's beloved. It's kind of interesting to think that it was, you know, received mixed reviews. I wonder how Ebert is going to respond to this one. Hey. This is the worst scene in the movie.
Hello?
This is like Don Mincy level.
Hundred attempts at humor in this picture, and one of them was when Chevy Chase lights up his house with Christmas lights. There are a lot of lights. In fact, it looks like the sun is in that neighborhood. But other than that, the humor is all of the nerdy in-law, nerdy neighbor variety. There's no comic energy in the story. The Griswolds can be funny when they go on vacation, but not here when they stay stuck at home.
Well, I probably laughed more than twice, and I would probably give it a better review than you would, but I can't recommend it. And it seemed to me that what we had here were all the elements, and they just weren't quite firing. For example, when the in-laws turn up, they're not very funny, and they're not really differentiated, and they're not really made.
See, I think this is maybe one of the best, if not the best, National Lampoon movie.
Really dumb
and
for them.
That's
and the whole business of how he gets trapped in the
damning it with the faintest of praise.
A whole series of physical gags, but really, they don't quite pay off. And over in the movie, I kept thinking, gosh, it's here. They just give it that extra push. Maybe it's the director or...
Well, I'll tell you, the director comes...
Who
the director
couldn't quite get it over the
it's
top.
It's a first-time director who comes from making TV commercials, and he doesn't make the transition very well. In addition, I thought... I mean, I really didn't like the film and felt disappointed in it because they can be funny on vacation. Why not take them on a trip again? Mm-hmm. It works twice. Why keep them stuck at home in one location? I thought of Cannonball Run 2, where they didn't have the energy or the wherewithal to take the people on a real cross-country trip.
Yeah.
I watched Cannonball Run 2 kind of recently.
That's why they didn't go on vacation here, but I wish
pretty rotten.
More somewhere than where it went.
Coming up next at the movies, a film with Mary Steenburgen playing a woman who does not believe in Christmas.
Santa Claus.
Can you blame her?
One sleigh, carry all the toys for all the kids every place.
Because it's a magic sleigh.
Our next film is called One Magic Christmas, but its real title ought to be One Miserable Woman. I think somewhere buried in this film's intention is the desire to duplicate the same sort of desperation followed by joy that we saw in Frank Capra's classic with Jimmy Stewart, It's a Wonderful Life. Like Jimmy Stewart in that movie, Mary Steenburgen in One Magic Christmas plays a very depressed person. A put-upon woman.
I don't know why that turn of phrase tickled me.
They're being forced out of their home. She argues with her boss in the supermarket where she works as a checker. Her husband gets shot almost fatally during a bank holdup. Her kids are kidnapped and apparently drowned
like
in
that.
A traffic accident. And little does she know that there is, fortunately, a guardian angel watching over her and her family. And in this scene, late in the film, her daughter gets a trip thanks to the guardian angel.
Coming up
to the North Pole.
You know what? Sprinkled throughout this, I'm going to rank the National Lampoon films. Which will be very exciting for a lot of you.
Because the Santa Claus in the mall isn't me.
But I have to,
Santa Claus, how can one sleigh carry all the toys for all the kids every place?
Because it's a magic sleigh.
I might have to,
very magic.
Weed through my list here. Because some of these aren't actually National Lampoon movies.
Do you believe in magic, Abby?
Ugh, that's...
Your lunch, Nicholas?
I don't like that.
Oh, yes.
Have a nice trip.
Yes. Take care of Abby. Make sure that she gets home. And I'll see you...
Sounds like Santa has the TV on. It's like when I was in junior high and I would film skits for school projects, and I would leave the TV on.
Even Santa
on
seems like he's on tranquilizers. Now, when the daughter returns home, her brother doesn't believe where she's been, but little Abby has seen Santa and the guardian angel, so she sticks to her story.
That looks like me, that little boy.
Santa
that
Claus.
Looks like how
Santa
I looked
not
when
see
I was
Santa Claus.
A kid. When I was a
stone. Give me back my glass ball.
Who needs it? I'm gonna tell Mom you're back, and you're gonna get it, Abby. You're gonna get it good.
I like that room, though.
I told you, Mom. I told you she was back.
You going back downstairs?
It's got like
I
Tonka
to
trucks
Abby.
On the wallpaper.
Oh, Mom, do
that's
I have
cool.
To...
Yeah, you have to. Go on.
Yes, Mom.
Come on.
Wish I had wallpaper like that. I'd probably try to play with all the trucks. I'd probably keep, like, banging on the
wall. Abby? Where have you been? We've all been worried sick.
Is there a blood...
She's Santa Claus.
There's a bloody handprint on the wall back there.
Don't tell me stories like that.
No, Mom, really. Gideon took me there. He can fly. You gonna spank me, Mom?
No, I'm not. But you shouldn't tell Fibs.
Okay, good.
But it's true. There is an angel. You know there's an angel. Or Cal and I would be drowned in the river.
See, Gideon is the name of that angel. And boy, wasn't that whole level of that scene there just very, very down and depressing. Her standing in the doorway, mumbling to her son, then mumbling to her daughter. That is the emotional tone of this entire film, except for the happy ending. One Magic Christmas is a very strange movie. It's really unbelievably downbeat to the point it really gets on one's nerves, despite the presence of the usually likable Mary Steenburgen, one of my favorite actresses. And I also think that the fine actor Harry Dean Stanton, he of the craggy face, is wildly miscast as the guardian angel Gideon.
Mary Steenburgen, full frontal nudity in the film Melvin and Howard.
So we
just
think
a
if
little,
we see him walking through the streets that he'd be picked up for vagrancy in any town where he spends as much time as he does in this film. So we get
little recommendation
for more than an hour, and then whammo, the predictable
happy
ending that the film simply has not earned. That's why I felt totally manipulated by this movie.
But you should at least seek out that scene.
Too much of a downer all the way through.
From aznudes.com. Check it out.
Looking at it from a totally different
point
of view,
just type,
movie.
Check out her whole page on aznudes.com.
The Gray Fox. Mary Steenburgen is fine in this movie. All the performances are fine. You get to the North Pole, and Santa's workshop looks terrific. The little town where these people, where the family lives, that looks terrific. The acting is good. From a technical point of view, it's a well-made movie, but it's such a tragic miscalculation in terms of the screenplay.
Siskel's, you know, he's got a little,
He loses his job, they get thrown out of the house.
He snuck a little caffeine powder
in order to make the point. And that's why it just goes way over the edge, especially for younger kids. Oh, yeah. They're going to be totally baffled by this movie before it ever gets to the happy ending.
It looks like that looks like a dreary one.
It's two separate movies, really, because I don't know that there's ever been such
an unhappy portrait
put on film.
That's about it.
And then you got this other thing coming in from left field, which is a conventional happy ending. I mean, maybe there should have been something conventionally unhappy about the ending, and it'd be all of a piece. All
right, so my number 15.
I walked out of the movie just thankful they didn't have a family dog, because it probably would have been
I've only seen 15 National Lampoon films.
Happier Christmas movie,
at the bottom
again,
of the list, Class of 1986, a filmed
extra kisses,
stage review from 1986. Sorry.
That's what
with,
our next movie is named Santa Claus the Movie.
Michael
that's
C.
Good
Higgins.
Because Santa Claus the Book, it'd never
he's
be
in
on
it.
Our show. It's a big budget special effects spectacular.
Pathetic,
from Alexander
unfunny.
Salkin, the same man who gave us all the Superman movies. He adopts in this one sort of the same approach as he did in the Superman film, starting out with a story of the origin of his latest superhero, and then giving him some villains to fight and some friends to help out. Of course, the legend of Santa Claus doesn't begin
it'll
with Santa's a little baby
this is,
like
this
Superman
is, this will be
was.
Practice
I guess
for when everyone
maybe because Santa Claus was
me.
Never young.
Once
it begins when a kindly man named Claus freezes to death while delivering Christmas presents, and his spirit is whisked directly to the North Pole for a chat with the elves, where he gets a promotion of sorts and a new name.
I've never seen this movie.
From this day on, now and forever, you will bring our gifts to all the children.
I think I own this.
In all the world.
I think I have this on VHS.
All those within the sound of my voice, and all those on this earth everywhere know, henceforth, you will be called Santa Claus.
I can't see
everyone.
It from where I'm sitting, so I'm not going to try to find it.
Merry Christmas.
But I'm pretty sure it's over. This looks...
That's Burgess Meredith as the ancient elf there. The movie stars Dudley Moore as Santa's chief elf. And in this scene, he tries to make a deal with a crooked toy manufacturer played by John Lithgow.
better be. How many workers does this product require?
Just me?
What? No payroll?
Well, my needs are simple. A bowl of stew, heavy on the dill.
Why are they even showing this? This is a movie called Santa Claus. We're wasting scenes on this elf.
For nothing. We're going to give them away free. Oh, that's fantastic. How do you turn your face so red so fast?
For free!
Well, that's how we do it at the North Pole.
Well, that's not how we do it here!
Yeah, well, don't worry. We're going to give more to the rich kids.
On the other hand, this would go a long way towards cleaning up my public image.
Excuse me?
Oh, that's a bad investment. All that good PR. I'm intrigued.
Excuse me, you're drooling on your tie.
The movie spends a lot of time with those two characters, maybe because, let's face it, Santa Claus isn't that interesting. Neither is this movie. It has a lot of fairly good special effects.
Ebert's chuckle when they come out of the clip there.
Sort of a standard Superman style villain by John Lithgow, but there's never really any suspense because we never ever really think that anything very bad is going to happen to Santa Claus. I guess that's maybe because we hadn't seen One Magic Christmas before. I sort of like parts of this movie, but not enough to recommend it. Of course, I might have liked it more if I'd been 7 years old, and maybe that's the idea. At least no families get wiped out in this movie. I mean, a couple of reindeer get the flu, and that's about the extent of it.
Well, I'll tell you, now I think if you hit on the problem. You see, this film, I think, could use more actual conflict in it.
What the fuck is that?
You talked about villains going against the superhero, like in Superman, but think about it. There is not one scene in this movie between
Santa Claus and John Lithgow. That you just did.
That's right.
There is no confrontation between the good is good mm-hmm. and the most evil.
Really, maybe you should have had a kind of a more megalomaniac global type of
I got a
Christmas
idea.
Funny as hell.
He puts up a force shield that prevents the sled from landing. Oh, wouldn't that be great?
Well, I got a better one.
It's up to Dudley Moore.
He kidnaps Santa Claus, and he becomes Santa Claus. You have an evil Santa Claus out there who does all kinds of funny things, not sick things, but funny things, and that's the John Lithgow character. I came up with that. That's worth $500,000 in Hollywood.
That is a decent premise. John Lithgow is kind of a campy...
Coming up next,
a special report on the
Raising Kane-esque Santa Claus. I've never actually seen that movie.
Gave thumbs down to
but I bet
ago.
That's a very funny
now,
reference that I just
see
made.
That we didn't.
We'll analyze the movie's success when we come back.
Kevin!
Happy holidays, Dave.
Thank you.
Oh, nice.
There sure is a lot to do during the holidays. In fact,
oh, I
if
love that they
careful,
put commercials
Dave,
in this.
You could really work up an appetite.
Boy, I'm hungry.
Luckily, Wendy's has a big bacon classic combo, a quarter pound of fresh beef, three strips of bacon cheese,
I do love Christmas
lots of toppings, biggie fries, and a 20-ounce drink. A delicious meal.
Like the tree. Here goes.
I love seeing those M&Ms drop dead.
I love
dead.
The holidays.
Try Wendy's big bacon classic combo.
I didn't know what to get anyone for the holidays. My Aunt Esther is always...
I forgot to turn on my space heater.
Uncle Charlie, shopping for him is an adventure. Now, my nephew Timmy was easy. All he wanted was... this from Blockbuster Video. Then it hit me. I could make everyone happy at Blockbuster. And with Blockbuster gift certificates, Aunt Esther can rent all kinds of mysteries. Uncle Charlie can choose his own adventures. And I can have a wonderful life.
Blockbuster Video.
Give the gift of entertainment.
Honestly, that's all I want.
For one of America's favorite characters, can one tiny reindeer save the day on a stormy Christmas Eve? Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, Tuesday at 8, 7 Central and Mountain.
Just put more credit on my movie madness
movie
account.
Home Alone bounced around from one studio to another because nobody thought it would have much promise at the box office, but now it's about to become the biggest hit of all films released in 1990. Directed by Chris Columbus
alone,
and written and produced
alone,
by John Hughes,
Kevin's
who specializes
alone.
In movies about kids and families and teenagers, and this time, they really hit the jackpot. Almost every scene in the movie involves a previously little-known young actor named Macaulay Culkin, who was inadvertently
I love this movie so much. I remember
extended family and relatives all over
seeing the commercials for it and just writing my own version of it, like a comic book version of it. Hey, Chad.
Oh.
No.
Don't worry, Marv. I'll get him for you.
Okay, so I've said this recently before to some people who are here.
For nearly 3 months, Home Alone has stood at the top of the box office charts week after week after week.
When I first saw Home Alone, I misunderstood the opening scene. I thought that Marv, as the cop, was a real cop. I thought he was there because that's what you do when you're a rich person, is you hire a police officer to oversee the packing. And I thought he was just like a crooked cop who decided to become a burglar.
I guess maybe that must have been like criticizing West Side Story because
I think it was the first idea. It was the first concept I ever had of somebody pretending to be a cop. So it took me a few viewings to figure that out.
Troubled times right now.
Harry,
and Home Alone offers the exact opposite of the headlines on the news. It's funny, it's lightweight, it's escapist, it's a fantasy, it's a comedy, it's about a little kid. It shows the kid using his ingenuity to outsmart the bad guys, and the audience seems
I just
to be
got your NBC the slap joke it, finally. I'm not? Sorry, it took me
the
a while.
The possibility is part of the fun. And to quote another ad about another movie, boy, do we need it now.
Well, I think that the secret has to do with they did tap into
for a very long time.
We both talked about that in our original review, which was
I'm talking like in the last few years.
A frightening thing. I remember the first time
I had a Home Alone giveaway poster.
I stood by the window.
That was
just waiting for my family.
It was like a
home.
Giveaway so with Pepsi or something
start
like that.
With that. What we both felt is that
and it was a poster that like it was like a drawn poster that showed where all the booby traps are in the house. I loved it so much.
The reason I'm trying to explain how could we be
I still have it. I just haven't put it up
if that's what we really are. And I think that maybe it has a lot to do with slapstick, which is such a special taste. In other words, you either buy somebody's idea of physical slapstick or you don't at all. And I didn't laugh at all during all of the stuff.
I recently watched a bunch of like a YouTube compilation or not compilation. It was like a YouTube thing where they were just explaining how they did all the like effects in the movie. And it was pretty interesting.
Much like The Breakfast Club and Planes, Trains, and Automobiles.
Yes.
And who takes a very
like they slowed it down
idea.
And zoomed
every
in on it where you can see like
kid gets a day off from school. Plane, strange,
you know,
automobile.
It's a rubber
two people
nail
trying to get home for Thanksgiving.
Right.
Breakfast Club. Four kids stuck in detention after school.
Right.
Very
the part where
everybody can identify with and then
Harry
develops it in a way that is more or less
gets torched
accessible and yet at the same
is
time,
actually like a practical
little,
in camera effect
in there.
That's
and
they that is accomplished
really
with like mirrors.
For us, but
I think.
All along, it's interesting that he takes these.
Or might have been a composite shot.
Everyday,
I don't know. It was interesting.
American experiences. He doesn't go for. It's not.
And you can see like a little bit of the like.
It's just everyday stuff.
Yeah, he's along with Spielberg.
Like he had to hit his
Spielberg
mark exact
suburbia,
for the effect to work, and he didn't do it quite exact.
Other thing that was going on in the film was
you can see like
Christmas,
a glass reflection
subtext.
In the effect.
And I think that's a
neat,
very powerful
neat stuff.
Thing. People hunger for
movie magic.
A heartfelt Christmas movie, I think 12 months a year, actually. Mm-hmm. And the business with the neighbor next door, which I thought was so
petty. Tonight, we're having a short stream.
Christopher Columbus, the Christmas
and then I'm
the
going
director.
To have a super
I mean,
secret after show
very badly made.
Where I'm
not
going to be on
real
camera
real
or on mic.
Schwarzenegger, who started the year
and it's just going to be.
Finished with a loser,
I'm going to just show a bunch of stuff.
Lame story of a workaholic dad who has
just
to
for fun.
To find a sold out
and hopefully. Hopefully everything I show you is in the public domain.
And that's all there is to the story. None of the Schwarzenegger trademarks of high-tech, big action, or good humor. His three kids' films, Kindergarten Cop, Junior, and now Jingle All the Way, have been lame. He has to learn to select smarter.
I don't even know what that is.
Christmas Story, a funny memory about growing up in Gary, Indiana.
It's very funny. A Christmas Story is based on the writing.
Tell
of
your kids goodnight from Stranger on the Internet.
And joys of his growing up in the Midwest in the 40s. The film is a collection of incidents told with an adult narrator looking back on his youth with a smile. For example, a Christmas wish for a BB rifle.
Wait, the Jingle All the Way.
I heard myself blurted out.
I want an official Red Ryder Cup and action 2-inch Joe Wayne's ball air rifle.
Ooh.
I never liked that movie.
Shoot your eye out.
Oh no, it was the classic mother BB gun block.
But I always said to myself, wherever that was shot seems like a really nice place with really nice people.
Was not surmountable by any means known to kid to.
I'm always saying nice things.
The movie is when little Ralphie visits Santa Claus at a department store and asks for the same rifle.
Come on up there. Ho, ho, ho.
I genuinely love this movie, but yeah, I playing it for 24 hours every year did not do this movie any favors. I will say that.
For Christmas, little boy. My mind had gone blank. Frantic.
There is a made-for-TV sequel to this movie called something like Holly, Molly Hop Noodles Haven of Bliss. I think is what it's called. I remember watching it in class once.
Football. Oh, no.
I mean, like, all the characters are recast, obviously, but it's Gene Shepard doing the narration. And then there's that movie that there's a summer story or something like that. I've never seen that. But it has Charles Grodin and Mary Steenburgen. It's like a Clifford reunion.
Merry Christmas.
You know, we have seen so many movies lately about people trying to do great things, you know, fly to another planet, save the world. Here is something with just as much tension, and it's about a kid wanting a little BB rifle. It's
I
a sweet movie.
Saw one person I kind of, whose review, whose taste you, I sort of trust, that say that it was actually very
that
good.
Emotion from somewhere in our youth.
I'm not going to watch
full
it.
Of wonderful
but
scenes like those. It's a fragile movie. No sex,
maybe
no
it's good.
Violence. I really wonder if anyone is going to see it. I
classy,
sure hope they do.
Classy.
I'll tell you, my guess is either because it will catch on. It's the kind of movie that everyone could identify with. And from those clips, we might have given the impression that it's sort of a Norman Rockwell movie. But in a way, this is Norman Rockwell is filtered through the pages of Mad Magazine or the National Lampoon, because Gene Shepard.
This is Norman Rockwell with a pulse.
Kind of satirical, and he kind of remembers the bite and even the violence of being a kid and thinking about things so passionately that there's just
it's
no
not
room
like
for compromise.
It's a wonderful film, and it was directed by, of all people, Bob Clark, who made two of the films that you and I hate the most, Porky's 1 and Porky's 2. We like what he's remembering this time about his youth.
Way to go, Bob.
This is handled with so much more intelligence and simplicity than the most American films. That's
Romay
what I
always has so much insight into human nature.
Bad sound.
When I was in high school, that's a long time ago. Yes. When I was 14 years old, a girl wanted to break up with me. And you know what she told me? She said, she likes you. And the moment that I heard that, I just turned away to the one who did like me, you see, because I was such a pushover for the fact that I was being accepted. I think there's something of that in everybody at every age, that one of the most amazingly attractive things about a woman, Gene, is the fact that she likes you.
Well,
that makes her attractive. Well, shows what good sense she has.
Yes, I can't argue with
What's happening right now?
I don't know what that has to do with the movie, except that we now know what happened to Roger at 14. Coming up next, Die Hard, with Bruce Willis up against a gang of crazy terrorists who have occupied a skyscraper.
Share the magic of America's best-loved holiday tales this Christmas season.
Freaking smartass of generations with his Die Hard as a Christmas movie.
From Family Home Entertainment.
Okay, Rudolph, full power!
Like the timeless Christmas treat, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, with very merry music by Burl Ives. Then, it's everybody's favorite tale of Frosty the Snowman.
Okay, yeah, Die Hard's a Christmas movie. Go is a Christmas movie. The Last Boy Scout is a Christmas movie. Lethal Weapon is a Christmas movie.
And the Great Red Astaire sings up a story in Santa Claus is Coming to Town, also starring the voice of Mickey Rooney.
Gremlins.
There's more Yuletide magic.
Gremlins is obviously a Christmas movie. First Blood.
Of the Vienna Boys Choir.
That's a Christmas movie.
The Red-Nosed Reindeer.
Frosty the Snowman, Santa Claus is
Friends of Eddie Coyle. I just made that up. I don't know if that's a Christmas movie.
Classics for you to take home and treasure this holiday season from family home entertainment.
I think I was thinking of French Connections. Christmas movie.
With a chance of winning a present from Mario in the Pepsi Nintendo holiday game, where you could win thousands of terrific Nintendo prizes.
I'm like pretending to play it right now. With a Game Boy instead of a controller. I don't have a controller handy.
The sensational new Game Boy. So hurry up and play before it's all over. Look for details on how to win your Nintendo prize wherever you see these Pepsi holiday displays.
One cold winter's eve, Bertie and Grimace wandered McDonald's land in search of
a gift for Ronald.
Got any bright ideas?
When lo and behold, a little star hops.
You're supposed to play video games on Twitch, right? Down to
Earth. Look, Grimace, a falling star.
Ooh, maybe we can catch it.
And so they did.
You'll make the perfect gift for Ronald.
The little star was wrapped and ribboned.
I won.
And given.
Oh, dear me.
Twinkle, it didn't.
You see, Bertie and Grimace, a star can never belong just to me.
This is a sad one.
High for everyone to see. So let's wish him home, where he'll twinkle and glow.
And so they did, as they stood in the snow.
Look, the star's back at home in the sky. Good as new.
It looks like a glob of cum.
Friends like you. Happy
My cum. Looks like my cum.
Our next movie is named Die Hard, and it stars Bruce Willis as an off-duty policeman who attends an office party in a Los
Angeles. I'm baffled by the modern
and is overlooked when
TV ratings
occupy the building and round up all of the other people. Hiding out on a floor that's still under construction, he wages a one-man war against the bad guys
on this vintage video.
Radio contact with Reginald Bell Johnson as a cop down on the ground.
I want you to find my wife. Don't ask me how. By then you'll know.
I like Ronald.
I want you to tell her something.
He's the leader of the McDonald's land gang.
Tell her it took me a while to figure out.
Tell her I said Merry Christmas.
The movie is filled with wall-to-wall action, a lot of it based on the inability of the LA cops to believe that Willis himself is really a cop and not a tricky terrorist.
I didn't see this one
till
I was an adult. I was too scared of movies like this when I was little. I didn't even want to see them. I mean, that's not totally true. I went from being scared of them to being just like bored by the idea of them. I only ever wanted to watch comedy stuff when I was little. Like any movie that wasn't a comedy just seemed like a waste of time.
And you got just a glimpse there of the guy in the beard. That's Alan Rickman, who plays the villain and who's really the most interesting character in the movie. Kind of an intellectual.
Ebert looks a little disheveled here.
Delusions of superiority. Die Hard has a lot of action scenes like the one on the roof. So many of them, you're amazed the skyscraper doesn't turn into.
He looks like he lives in an old folks home.
Down the elevator shaft and whole floors are being blown apart. But you can also see there, I think, one of the big weaknesses of the movie, and that's the idiotic behavior of the Los Angeles Police Department. There was one character in this movie, a deputy chief, whose actions are so stupid and so unmotivated and wrong-headed that finally he just brings the movie to a stop every time he opens his mouth. Bad writing. He always says the wrong thing. He understands nothing. And with a movie like this, once you start picking out the loopholes, and there are a lot of them,
I'm wearing a state
shirt. How good the stunts or the special effects are, or even how good Bruce Willis is, you just can't stay interested.
I did stay interested because I saw this as really a mano a mano between Bruce Willis, who I think is very good in the film, and Alan Rickman, who is really quite devilish and quite sinister and threatening. And I also like the fact that it is held in the skyscraper, so there is some claustrophobia involving this terrorist, seeming terrorist attack. There's also a byplay relationship between Willis and his woman, his former wife, and they want to get that going. She's one of the people that's being captured. But basically, I thought of two guys trapped in a tower trying to fight it out, and I bought the film.
Well, what about all the cops on the ground? What about this deputy?
But they stay away from them. They They stay away from
Willis
him.
Willis is brought down to the ground,
yes,
which is a miracle considering that all
I saw the Stella short that parodies Die Hard before I saw Die Hard.
We're going to bill you for all the damage you've caused.
There are always...
You want to groan at things
there
like
are idiotic
that.
Cops in the Dirty Harry movies, too, when you laugh at them. Come on, because Harry's smarter.
This is not an idiotic cop. This is idiotic writing to make a cop like this when it would have been better if he just pushed the action forward instead of constantly being wrong.
It's another esteemed classic that it turns out had mixed reviews back when it was new.
Hiya, pal.
It happened again?
Macaulay Culkin, the most popular lost kid in movie history, goes astray once again in Home Alone 2, Lost in New York.
Everyone I know who has seen this picture says pretty much the same thing, that it's essentially a carbon copy of the first film, and that was my reaction too. Macaulay Culkin, who else again stars as Kevin, and the second time around, we can really appreciate his talent. He is
the scene where Marv gets electrocuted is pretty incredible.
As he realizes he and his family have jumped on separate planes for their Christmas vacation.
Oh no, my family's in Florida and I'm in New York. My family's in Florida. I'm in New York.
I can go
Little
see a
Kevin
show at the Comedy Cellar.
Plaza Hotel, pretending he's waiting for his father. Naturally, he has a ball with the hotel staff, including Bellman Rob Schneider.
Is everything all right?
Bell and Rob Schneider.
Is the temperature in the room okay?
It's okay.
Do you know how the TV works?
I'm 10 years old. TV's my life.
Hell yeah.
Well.
Still my life.
And there's plenty more where that came from.
Out on the streets, as
I knew somebody,
a threatening stranger who turns out to be a nice
I had a customer at a job
a
who would tip
Brenda Fricker, the Oscar winner, as
with
the
gum.
My left foot. They have a nice scene.
And I only found it charming. Because it was the kind of place where you only a few people tipped. Like, it wasn't a...
That's okay. You're really good at it.
It wasn't expected.
You don't mumble or spit when you talk.
But he would always give us some sort of unique
gum. Pigeon poop on it.
Then the burglars played by Joe Pesci
like
Daniel
like fancy Churchill, international
like
gum. Like gum that you couldn't buy in the grocery store. It'd be like in Japanese on the label or something.
I gave a marginal thumbs
That's
down
a really good idea along. For a guy to be.
Like those burglars. This time I
you know, just special order foreign gum and give it out to strangers. And people will be like, oh, I remember that guy.
Even more annoying, again, marginal thumbs down for me on Home Alone 2. And I know that every 10-year-old...
He gave me a purple stick of gum
that
had Korean writing on it.
My thumb is not even marginally down.
I wasn't sure what the flavor
all,
was.
I didn't even go for the Brenda Fricker scenes because I thought that they went on way too long, were overwritten and treacly and sentimental and shameless in the way that the little twerp kind of lectures her on the meaning of life and the meaning of truth. And
so that little
out
twerp.
These words of wisdom from his angelic little mouth. And then as far as the burglars are
yeah,
concerned,
the
violence, which is
the
schmaltz in
Home Alone 2.
It
was pretty,
with the
unforgivable.
And Wile E. Coyote, and they use the wide-angle lens to make it seem that things are really coming from a long way down and slamming on top of everyone, is really tough stuff. You know, usually live action.
Did you know that that's when Marv gets electrocuted? That's Daniel Stern's real skeleton.
That this kid is a big talent.
Oh, I think Macaulay Culkin. I'm not. No, I'm
I forgot
not
to be giving my
Culkin
to be ranking National Lampoon movies. I'm sorry.
Who
number 14,
of, Kevin goes along,
National
right?
Lampoon's Movie Madness, which I own on Blu-ray.
When he's dropping 50-pound bags
That's
of cement
the
on them and tricking them.
Number 13, Joy of Sex, which isn't really a
so
National
forth.
Lampoon
I mean,
movie.
This stuff, it may even sound funny when I describe it, but the
but
fact
they
is
were attached at one point.
Real
they really had nothing to do with it. Number 12,
when we come back,
Disco
we
Beaver from Outer Space.
Classic Miracle on 34th Street, this time with Richard Attenborough as Kris Kringle.
That was a TV special. It was a sketch comedy thing. They adapted Dracula. Not very good. Was not nothing good about it. Wow, that's a good cat. Number 11, Vegas Vacation. put thoughts together. Number 10, European Vacation, which is worse than you remember if you haven't watched it in a while. It's pathetic and sweaty.
Ow!
So you think Santa will like these red and green M&Ms?
I don't know. I never met the guy. He does exist!
They do exist.
Yes!
Santa?
R.I.P.
We had just finished trimming the tree, and something weird was coming from the kitchen.
What's a tree doing in here?
Just one of the new shapes for my Christmas Crunch cereal.
Captain Crunch?
Christmas Crunch has six crunchy new shapes, like bikes, trains, stars.
He'll never do it.
Even Christmas trees.
He did it.
Then I add my holiday berry flavor, and you've got a crunchy, fruity part of a balanced breakfast. That's three down, only 59 million to go. Christmas Crunch, a whole lot of fun.
Would you be our Santa Claus?
Me?
Well, do you have any experience?
Just a little.
Great, well, I'm sure you'll be fine.
I'm gonna take
this. A department store executive spots a potential Santa Claus and hires him on the spot in that scene from Miracle on 34th Street, a new version of the 1947 classic. And if you've seen the original, you won't find many surprises in this remake, which is good-hearted, however, on its own terms.
I remember liking this
Richard
movie
Attenborough as Chris Kringle, who becomes the most popular department store Santa in town. But the woman who hired him, played by Elizabeth Perkins, doesn't believe in Santa and has taught her six-year-old daughter, played by Mara Wilson, to think the same way. The little girl is wise beyond her years
she raised
as a
her
neighbor
kid
finds out at Thanksgiving.
For the chef?
Oh, in the loosest sense of the word.
In every sense of the word.
The vegetables are catered, so is dessert.
Thank you, Susan.
You're welcome.
Under the circumstances, the little girl isn't too thrilled by the prospect of a chat with Santa Claus.
I know how this all works. You're an employee of Kohl's.
That is
too many of these movies,
you're
like, have
Santa Claus.
Thank
your beard,
you know,
real tight. Usually the store Santa Claus was.
They have these scenes where it's like just Santa and a small child on Santa's lap, and it's just like. I mean, we're just hanging out here. It's not like this is a riff track show or anything like that. But it kind of.
Would it be okay if I thought about this more? I have to not believe
I find myself
Claus
like
right
I find myself
Meanwhile,
resisting
Chris Kringle is tricked by evil employees of a rival department store and ends up institutionalized because he's
one it's not that
really
clever
Santa Claus just
but,
like in the original
you know.
Film it all comes down to a court hearing between faith and cynicism.
Well, I would greatly like to oblige Mr. Collins, but I cannot make this reindeer fly.
I didn't think so.
The only fly is on Christmas Eve.
I like this movie for its sweet, unhurried tone.
I did not know what Kohl's was until rather than
trying to recycle it
much
into
later.
Some kind of flashy,
I don't think we had
modernism.
A Kohl's
Nothing
when
will
this
ever
movie
replace
was
the
in
original
my life.
Classic with its Oscar-winning performance by Edmund Gwynn as Santa Claus. But by realizing that, the makers of this new Miracle on 34th Street have been able to share some of the same spirit in a holiday film that I think has a lot of quiet charm.
Well, I want to focus on the word quiet. I think we like the same thing here. This is a very respectful film of the other film and of the holiday and of the characters in it. It's very well cast. The writing is clean as can be. The scenes play elemental. It's classically made. Mm-hmm. And I think that's why we like it, even though I will tell you that the ending that they came up with which is different from the classic ending of the first film, doesn't work at all, in my opinion.
Well, oddly enough, Gene, you may be referring to a wedding scene. And since I was married in the same church where that wedding scene takes place, it kind of touched my heart.
I knew you were. In fact, when I took my daughter there and she was a flower girl in the same, I pointed it out to her, too.
Okay.
Not at all. I'm talking about in the courtroom. And that's which doesn't work at all.
Okay,
but otherwise,
you like the letters, the bags of mail.
You
that
got
came
that.
In. Okay, coming up next.
One of Santa's reindeer needs a temporary home. And
I didn't have any, like, Christmas books. I was like looking.
That crazy bunch you grew up with?
What I was hoping was that I had like a like a traditional book of just you know.
Hope we're going
the
to
night had like
party.
Christmas stories in it.
I
want to
go to a
like the night before Christmas, because I thought it would be funny if I started the show by like a sincere reading from the book. But this is the closest thing I could think of that I have that's even this Dan Clowes comic
That's all you
about
packs
a sensual Santa. It's found in this big box set 50 cents of each, ball that I have. This might be childish, but I genuinely love showing off the stupid shit that I own. It's like literally one of my favorite things. And I was thinking about making a YouTube series where all I do is just show off the stupid shit that I have. Look at the cover. The cover's so cool. Oh, man. Look, this is what one side of the spine looks like. It's two books.
Christmas story called Prancer, shot on location in Southwest Michigan. It tells the story of a little girl named Jessica who lives on a poor farm but becomes a celebrity in town after she discovers a wounded reindeer near her home. A reindeer she believes is Santa's reindeer called Prancer.
I'm sorry, I don't have any time for chit chat.
I know. I remember this movie. Of
course I am.
But can you get this letter to him?
I didn't really watch this movie, but I remember scenes from this movie. I remember little kids putting this movie on in a house once where I was hanging out. And I watched some of it.
Prancer's in the shed near my house.
After Jessica's opinion of the reindeer becomes well known in town, the reindeer is locked, gets her wish to liberate Prancer. She has a reconciliation.
I went to a Kohl's for some reason. I think my mom got me a present. And it was like sent to that Kohl's.
That's what it would be like around here, not to have you around.
And
I love you, Jesse.
What keeps this little fable?
Seems like you know what? It seems like a pretty cool place.
Second, and much more important, the lead performance of Rebecca Harrell as little Jessica.
It honestly seems like a badass place to work. And that's just
perfect. Rather, her heart is dazzling. This is Rebecca
Seems
Harrell's
like you could meet some chicks
film, and she
there,
plays it very,
maybe some
well.
Dudes.
Smart and earnest and convincing. We believe that lots
Find
of
some people there to get into a fight with. You could go have a
Jessica.
Fist fight
that
with them.
Reason,
you could go to Kohl's and
I really like
have a fist
I
fight
like
in
too,
the parking
and I like
lot.
Rebecca Harrell too. And what I also liked was that they didn't make this movie into kind of a Norman Rockwell Christmas where everybody is ideal and everybody's right. happy and there's
I like to strut this stuff.
It's tough in the town. Yes, this apple farm that her father owns and operates is just about to go broke. There isn't much money. Her mother is dead. The Christmas may not be too cheerful for her, and yet she doesn't sit around and complain. She gets out there, and she's got gumption. She finds this reindeer. She hides it in a shed behind the house. She gets a part-time job to buy oats for it. She knows it's Prancer, and by the end of the movie, we practically believe it's Prancer, too, because the reality level of the movie
I got
is,
a Bart
is there. It's not just a
Check
favorite.
That out.
Well, that's where you have to credit the director, John Hancock,
cool.
for shooting it in a nice location and also shooting it kind of dark. And
sassy.
Not in the,
sassy saying.
When I think of the picture, you know what I think? I think of her wandering out in the woods, in the backwoods. I mean, that's the dominant image and not the Christmas carol.
Bart's
kind of,
not barefoot
holiday
in this
picture.
One, sorry.
And it's very, very good on that basis.
Christmas always seems to me like a real dark season. You know, it's cold and dark despite all of the images in the movies. And this one gets that.
Our next film is only 25 minutes long, but it is a major event in the movie world because it is the first new Mickey Mouse cartoon created in 30 years. Mm-hmm. It's Mickey's Christmas Carol, an adaptation of the well-known Charles Dickens story with Mickey as the
It's interesting that they did a review
Bob
for this.
Cratchit and rich old Scrooge McDuck as Bob Cratchit's boss, Scrooge. In this scene, Scrooge is taken by the ghost of Christmas present to see how poor Bob Cratchit and his family are being forced to celebrate the holidays.
Why did you bring me to this old shack?
I believe this was an early, if not the first, instance of Alan Young as Scrooge. Alan Young.
What's she cooking, a canary?
It's the voice of, Uncle Scrooge in DuckTales, the classic DuckTales.
That's your laundry. Not yet, children. We must wait for Tiny Tim.
Hi, Father.
Alan Young died a few years ago. He was like in his late 90s, and he was still doing the voice of Scrooge. He is, I think he's British. And,
Mr. Scrooge.
He was Wilbur Pope on Mr. Ed, doing an American accent. That's the same guy as Uncle Scrooge.
I see an empty chair.
He was the owner of Mr. Ed.
Now, I may be about to commit professional suicide, because how can you knock a movie with a cute little mouse on a cute little crutch? But that's my feeling, because that scene is deceptive. That is not what the whole movie is about. This movie has very few scenes with Mickey Mouse and his wonderful little family in it. This film does not rank with any of the classic Disney animated features. It's missing Mickey, frankly. He and his family are in far too few scenes.
He wants more Mickey.
This is only a genial and slightly colorful little stocking stuffer for kids. And I'll be a Scrooge. I give it thumbs down. I was very disappointed.
I can't believe my ears. Well, you're going to vote against Mickey's Christmas Carol?
Yes.
With Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck? I am too.
He's such
well,
a pimp.
I am too. No. I was disappointed as well. I'll tell
he
you two,
like, yeah.
two reasons that I thought.
Hell
first
yeah,
of all,
I did.
It's wall-to-wall
yeah,
words.
I did.
They
mm.
talk for the whole 25 minutes.
Fuck
they don't
that little guy.
The magic of visual animation that,
very
that
few
Disney people are famous for. And secondly, they don't change the story. This is simply Dickens' Christmas Carol.
This is just like that rich little
just like in the book.
Special.
Usually, in the old days of the Disney studio, they would have put an ironic spin on it. There would have been something satirical. They would have had fun with it. It would have been Mickey's version of this story. But instead, it's absolutely a forced march through the same old story.
I would have rather have seen the re-release of two of the old classic old Mickey Mouse. I'll stand two of those.
It's
old
not as you know, it's not as strong as the WKRP episode that parodies it.
I mean, I look forward to it.
It's
I wish they would Disney would make feature-length animated cartoon.
This is a
something
real
else
safe movie. They
that we might
that
see a little later on if you feel like watching stuff
little
after
bit more
this.
Than exactly what you were expecting. Yeah.
Okay, now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed on this show. Two thumbs down for National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation, which seems to have
that
surprised
me.
For a good comedy.
I thought maybe that one of them would go up
on the thriller
that.
Die Hard. I like the whole movie a lot better than he did. So Die Hard, I recommend.
Oh yeah.
Two thumbs down for Home Alone 2: Lost in New York. We both agree the violent burglar scenes were overdone.
Number 9, Lemmings.
Two thumbs up, however,
number 8,
of
Class Reunion. Number 7, O.C. and Stigs. Number 6,
Richard
the original Meet the
Parents,
Santa. Not the remake starring Ben Stiller. Largely unreleased, but it was at one point supposed to be a National Lampoon.
Two more thumbs down for
release.
One Magic Christmas, which is well acted and directed.
Senior Trip,
too much of a downer
Vacation.
For a holiday movie. And two more down thumbs for
Animal
Santa
House
Claus
number
movie.
3
conflict between good
Christmas
and evil.
Vacation
and
number
finally,
2
two thumbs down for Mickey's
and
Christmas
National
Carol,
Lampoon's Loaded Weapon 1 number 1.
Well, you know, we like Mickey, but we wish there were more of him in this film. A big disappointment.
Okay, that's it for this week. Next week we'll be back with reviews of big new films starring Steve Martin, Jodie Foster, and Julia Roberts. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.
All right.
It's America's favorite jelly bean, Jelly Bellies. Try them, you'll love them. Rice-A-Roni, the San Francisco treat. Now with 30 flavors, you can serve it every day for a month and never serve the same dish twice. Capri moisturizing foam.
All right,
foam,
so I didn't want to...
Natural floral essences and luxurious foam. Capri gives
I
you
I explained the convoluted
skin.
Situation.
Magla's reversible ironing cover with Teflon.
So what we're
going to
do...
Gives you two covers in one. Iron on either side. From Magla Home Helpers.
I figured since this was probably going to be a low turnout thing, we're going to end this stream. And if you would like to watch more stuff that isn't going to be available. We're just going to watch stuff. Some just fun, hopefully, public domain items. Hey, that's me. That's basically it for the show tonight. I'm sorry I kind of failed to promote this. I failed really to kind of pull together a cohesive concept, though I tried to. But what I do have is some stuff that I'm just going to show for fun. So the stream's going to end, and if you feel like watching stuff, I have 4... programs. They're probably things you've seen before. A lot of them probably are, but maybe you're in the mood to watch them. Some of them have their original commercials intact. Not all of them, but some of them do. And I'll be kind of wandering in and out if you feel like chatting during it. I'll be in the chat room. But that's it for tonight as far as the main show goes. So I'm going to end the stream. If you want to keep watching the after party, the after show, the where I'm not on camera, I'm not going to be on camera or on mic. But if you feel like watching stuff, hit refresh. But I'm going to say goodnight, everybody. And maybe we'll see you in a few seconds. It'll be a matter of seconds. So do click refresh, please. All right. Good night.